Good afternoon once again, and welcome back to Hattiesburg, Mississippi. Under overcast skies with temperatures in the lower 70s, calm winds, and a much drier field than we had a couple of hours ago, we've got a winner's bracket game against the league's top two teams, the 23rd-ranked Marshall Thundering Herd, the number one seed in this tournament, against the Panthers of FIU, the only team to take a series this year against Marshall and their ace, Jordan Dixon. Dixon comes in inside the circle here on the top of the first inning with the most wins in Conference USA, a record of 31-6 and an earned run average of 1.69. She's second, though, in earned run average to Shannon Sale, who will be inside this circle for the Panthers of FIU in the bottom of the inning. And the last time Sale lost was in game one of their three-game regular season set to Marshall. Sale has been dynamic in her last 10 starts, and we'll look at her numbers later there. But here is Dixon, 31-6 again. This is her 34th start, 45th appearance. And as we scheduled start time for 10 a.m. this morning, we've only had to wait 3.5 hours here in Hattiesburg. First pitch in with an official start time of 1:32 Central today. I'm Josh West. Again, happy to have you along for our entire crew, and not only our crew, but our grounds crew. What a phenomenal job they have done to get this field in working condition after it took right at an inch of rain in an hour. As Jackie Schoaf leads things off. Jackie Schoaf, the center fielder, the sophomore out of Bradenton, Florida. Schoaf had a good day yesterday with a couple of hits, an infield single, a run scored, and another single. Works the count to 2-1. Last time these two teams met, it was an 8-4 win in the third game of that series for Marshall against the Panthers. 2-1, fouled away by Schoaf, and it's 2-2. Dixon in that ball game went six innings, gave up three runs, none earned on three hits, walked six, struck out four, and threw 75 strikes and 116 pitches. But suffered her fifth loss in the season. She's lost only one time since then. Ground ball hit to first. Little backhand flip, but beating it out is Schoaf. My goodness, did you see the speed there? D'Orazio had to scramble to get over. DeShields did a nice job. Little no-look behind-the-back flip as if it was for a layup in basketball. Watch it again. Nifty little play, but had to wait on D'Orazio. Schoaf beats it out for her third hit of this tournament, her second infield hit. And so Schoaf is aboard. The record for FIU when scoring in the first inning this year is simply phenomenal. 23-1. It included a two-run home run by Stephanie Teixeira yesterday. And that record went from 22-1 to 23-1. FIU was able to get two runs in the first, tack on three more in the fourth, two more in the fifth of their 7-1 win over Louisiana Tech. Ashley Leone, the starting second baseman at the plate here. And Leone takes up and in. Leone, the senior out of Miami, Florida, out of Gulliver Prep, the transfer from Auburn. So many of those Gulliver Prep players that played travel ball with their head coach and Coach Rebhan early in their career. That one just barely foul. That will send Leone back to the batter's box with a two-strike count. But FIU does a good job to recruit the Tampa area, and so many of those local Miami players out of Gulliver Prep that have grown up with Coach Gator. 1-2, and it's lined and into right field, and then misplayed in right field as both runners will advance. So it'll go down as a single and an error in right, and so Schoaf to third. Leone is at second after the single, and then the E9 on Cauliflower out in right. We'll watch it again, try to see what happened there. and it just took a funny hop off the tip of her mitt, crawled right over the heel. Wasn't that your initial thought when you see that play happen is, well, did she not get the glove down all the way? Well, she did, and that had a little more steam on it than Cauliflower was expecting, and maybe that just gives even more credence to what I was saying about the ground screw here in Hattiesburg. The most attention, as Marshall going to get together and meet here with runners at second and third and no outs in the top of the first inning. Back to the field, though. The most attention was given right in front of the dugouts. And as you look there right behind the FIU coaches meeting on the third base side, you see it's very wet on the dirt at their feet. Now, just off the camera, to the left there of that shot, they had to actually lay down some mats and actually tape those mats together and make sure there weren't any lips on those mats. Every coach taking the utmost precaution to make sure that this game will be played out without a slip or a fall coming into the equation or a trip. And so here's Stephanie Teixeira, and I wouldn't expect her to really pitch here to her. Pitch way outside. You hate to load the bases in the first inning, but Stephanie Teixeira has simply been on a tear. And it's no wonder that she's second in the league in walks with 45. That pitch races up and in, and it's two balls and no strikes. Dixon certainly fearless to even give anything close here to Teixeira. 2-0 down and away. It's 3-0 to share the seniors' numbers. Phenomenal. Young lady out of Miami, out of Gulliver Prep, as we've been referencing. 379 hitter. 15 home runs, 52 RBI. Takes a strike there on 3-0. Teixeira tied for ninth in the league in terms of batting average. 3-1. And there's ball four. Not surprising. So with first base open, you put Teixeira aboard, but you take the bat out of her hands. It's a very smart play by Coach Shonda Stanton, the 18th year coach at Marshall, and you don't stay at a place 18 years if you aren't very good and making very wise decisions. And here comes Danny Mowry, the starting left fielder, and she takes a ball. An infield single, a single, then an error, and a walk. The bases loaded here with no outs for the Panthers in the top of the first inning. Swing and a miss. This is a young lady in Dixon on this field this year for Marshall. As a starter, she's had three shutouts. So if she gives up a run, it would be her first run. She's only given up one run, and that was in relief in game two in the Southern Miss series. And actually, I should say two runs, one earned. After another swinging strike by Mowry. Mowry, the 302 hitting senior, readies and fouls it back. So we have inside the circle now Conference USA's Pitcher of the Year, first team selection. Coming up in the bottom of the first in Shannon Sale, we have the Conference Freshman of the Year. And another one of those first-team selections as well. So we are certainly in for a treat. And game one against FIU, Dixon went seven innings, gave up just one run earned on six hits. Walked six, struck out two, as another foul away by Mowry. Faced 31 batters in that ball game. The numbers for Sale in the loss, seven innings, gave up two runs, both earned on four hits, struck out seven and walked three. It was a 2-1 loss for the Panthers, the hottest team in this tournament coming in. Just how hot? They've won 10 out of 11, including seven in a row, and 30 out of their 36 ball games. 1-2 pitch, and she chased the rise ball, and Dixon gets a big strikeout in the top of the first inning. So one away for the Thundering Herd. And this is such a critical, critical moment, and it comes in the top of the first inning, because again, we gave you those numbers that are staggering in terms of scoring in the first inning as a fastball strike to Cassandra Castle, the designated player. Castle, the junior, 265 hitter with 5 home runs and 38 RBI. 0-1 pitch is pulled away foul, and it's nothing and two. So Dixon is trying to settle back in, trying to find her way here in the top of the first inning. She's been in jams like this before. No balls, 2 strikes. And another strikeout for Dixon. So for Dixon, who came into today with 273 strikeouts, make it now 275, one of just 58 players in the history of this game with better than 100 wins and better than 1,000 strikeouts in her career. And she deals just out of the zone to the shortstop, Jessica Rivera. So an infield single to Schoaf. She's at third. Then a Leon single followed by an error that allowed Schoaf to advance at third and Leon to second. Then Teixeira, as you would expect, walked on 5 pitches. What does Dixon do? She comes back, attacks Mowry, gets the strikeout, attacks Castle, and gets the strikeout. Pretty impressive what we're seeing at this moment. One ball, no strikes. And it's fouled, back and out of play, and it's 1-1. So if you're the Panthers, you load the bases with no outs, and you're thinking, here we go. Now if Marshall comes back and gets out of this inning without letting a run scratch across, the momentum goes right back to the Thundering Herd, as another pitch is fouled back up and over the press box here at the Southern Miss Softball Complex. Rivera had an RBI single, scored a run in the fourth, that 3-run fourth in the 7-1 win yesterday over Louisiana Tech. High's ball high and the count evens. Dixon, though, has a chance to put Marshall even in that much better shape. 2-2, and it's outside, it's 3-2. You can't help but think that it had to have been talked about. Players, they're savvy. They read the notes, they read the headlines, they read the tweets. But I don't know if Coach Stanton would have relayed that to the team as the 3-2 pitch is fouled back again. Don't know if that's something you want psychologically in your team's head, but that's just one of those things that some teams can handle that information, some teams couldn't. Certainly you tell them about it if you get out of the inning. If you give up a couple of runs, you just let that stat go by the wayside. Payoff pitch, and there's a walk. And a run is in. Schoaf comes in. And so it's a 1-0 lead for the Panthers. And so they have scored now in the first inning, make it 25 games, and they've won 23 of the first 24 where they've done so. Leona third, Teixeira to second, Rivera's at first after an RBI walk, and Sammy Green is at the plate, the starting catcher. Sammy Green, the redshirt senior out of Marietta, Georgia, out of Lassiter High School. Seventh Panther to the plate here in this first inning. Time is called now by McCourt. She wants to go out and talk to Dixon. McCord is another one of the all-league players that litter the lineups today. Dixon, first-team pitcher. Morgan Zirkle, the player of the year in Conference USA, already drafted in the Pro League as well as a member of Team USA. McCord, the first-team all-league catcher. 2-0 strike, and McCord gave a little nice acknowledgement of that pitch. That's what McCord was looking for following their brief discussion. So Leon at third, to Teixeira at second, and Rivera at first. There's another strike, and it's 2-2. With a steady resolve of Dixon. Two-two is popped up, and with the beat on it is Zirkle. She'll put it away, and that will end the inning. A run on two hits and an error. Panthers by one as we go to the bottom of the first. You're watching BN Sports. Good look in at the Southern Miss Softball Complex. It's the 2017 Conference USA Softball Championship here in Hattiesburg. And as we go to the bottom of the first inning, it's the Conference USA Player of the Year, the shortstop Morgan Zirkle at the plate against Shannon Sale. Sale, the freshman, Conference USA's Freshman of the Year, an 18-8 record, making her 28th start in her 35th appearance, and a league-best 1.41 earned run average, as the 1-0 just misses as well, and it's two balls and no strikes. So 2-0 to Zirkle. Big swing and a miss at the rise ball, the signature pitch of Shannon Sale. Now, she might sail, pun intended, a few over the head of her catcher in Gilbert, but she is so, so good. 2-1, fouled away by Zirkle. It's 2-2. Sale on the year has worked 184 and a third innings, 22 complete games, has given up 48 runs, 37 earned on 87 hits, 218 strikeouts against 97 walks, and then that opponent batting average. Good gracious, opponents bat just 143 against her, and those are her season numbers. Wait till I tell you about her last 10 games. 2-2 pitch. Zirkle fouls it off. So Sale in her last 10 games, 8-0 with two saves, 65 strikeouts in 56 and two-thirds innings. She's given up just 18 hits. As a 2-2 pitch just popped up, foul ground, and an easy out for Green, and Zirkle is retired.
Next up,
So again, 8-0, two saves in the last 10 for Sale, 65 strikeouts in 56 and two-thirds innings, 18 hits, that's all she surrendered, a .12 ERA, and opponents batting just 105 against her. As the pitch comes in on a curveball to DeRozio that misses inside, it's 1-0. Alicia DeRozio, starting second baseman, swipes at a 1-0 offering. It's 1-1. The junior out of Claremont, Florida, out of Montverde Academy. 1-0 lead for the Panthers here in the bottom of the first inning. 1-1 pitch is fouled back as well, and it's 1-2. Jackie Schoaf, the leadoff hitter, got aboard with an infield single in the top of the first and came in to score. One ball, two strikes. DeRozio fights off another pitch. This is an FIU team that I would think would be in the field of 64 right now. RPI of 43. They've garnered enough votes to sit number 27 in the USA Today coaches poll. But a strength of schedule in the 230s, and I'll explain why. As nearly a called strike three. Pretty good pitch that time by Sale, and it's 2-2. A lot of teams that they scheduled had better seasons a year ago, and they never really hit their stride this year as DeRozio keeps fighting to stay alive. So a schedule that Coach Reb Hand and this team was excited about preseason never came to fruition, and now they're wanting to continue to pilot wins on that resume as DeRozio again just battling. Fouling off pitch after pitch. We're going to see a lot of batters today just dig in and try to make life miserable. Protect that plate at all costs against two pitchers that throw a lot of strikes. 2-2. And again, DeRozio up to the task. DeRozio on this season for this 41-8 Marshall squad has played in and started every game. Six doubles, three triples, and 20 runs batted in. A .411 average. And there's a ball, and it's 3-2. It's a murderer's row at the top of this Marshall lineup. Three of the top eight hitters in Conference USA. Zirkle, first in the league in terms of batting average. DeRozio, sixth. And McCord, eighth. Swing and a miss there on the 3-2, though. And Sale was able to sneak one past DeRozio. And there's two away with the bases empty here in the bottom of the first. Change up to Taylor McCord, misses high, and it's 1-0. The junior 374 hitter, 52 hits, 11 doubles, 12 home runs and 50 RBI. Quickly 2-0 to McCord. McCord, the junior out of Gilbert, Arizona. Curveball misses on 2-0, and it's now three balls and no strikes. Sale got the win in the third game against Marshall. 3-0 pitch, called strike, and it's 3-1. In that outing, she gave up just one run unearned on two hits, striking out five, walking four, faced 28 batters. And another called strike makes it 3-2. Threw 117 pitches in that outing, 75 strikes. Payoff pitch, and getting a piece of it that time. Fouling it back is McCord. count remains full to Taylor. And it misses low. So a two-out walk to Taylor McCord. The catcher is aboard.
Now batting the third baseman, number 44, Shaylen Braxton.
McCord second in the league in RBI behind Stephanie Teixeira. Here comes the cleanup hitter, Shaylen Braxton. Braxton an 0-for-3 day yesterday. Fouls back this first pitch to fall behind, nothing and one. 296 hitter with 47 hits, fourth best on this Marshall team. 11 doubles, 8 home runs, and 31 RBI. Marshall team that likes to run. It's a line drive, fair ball. Went off the glove of Green, trying to go first to third, and doing so on the play is McCord. And so that's going to end up being a double off the mitt that time of Green on a sharply hit ball. It'll put runners at second and third now with two outs. And so Marshall looking for the answer of that run by FIU in the top of the first. FIU, that run was their 57th run in the first inning in 57 games. We'll watch this again. Sharply hit off the glove of Green. And then into foul territory, and that sent everybody chasing. And a good job by Rivera to get over there quickly. So here is Elizabeth DeShields. DeShields, the starting first baseman, the freshman, a 309 hitter. Just 10 RBI on the season, but she's got a great chance here as first pitch is in for a strike. DeShields, the freshman out of Midwest City, Oklahoma. Oh, one pitch. Curveball just missed. One and one to DeShields. Pop up into center field. Shove's got it. And the inning is over. Runners get to second and third, but can't come home. It's FIU by a run as we go to the second on BN Sports. There you see, 8, 9, and 1. Gilbert, Bahadu, and Schoaf due up for the Panthers, who had sent 7 batters to the plate in the top of the first inning. Got a run on 2 hits, but stranded the bases loaded against Conference USA's best arm in Jordan Dixon, who deals a fastball strike, and it's nothing and 1. Julia Gilbert, the junior, a 177 hitter. She swings away and pops it up in foul ground, reaching up right at the rail. And putting it away is Braxton. And so there's one away, and that's why the grounds crew spent so much time working on getting those mats down, making sure a play like that would not end in a trip or a slip. So Bahadu, the right fielder, with the bases empty, one out. Here in the top of the second inning. In for a strike, and it's nothing and one. Bahadu, the freshman out of Miami, also out of Gulliver Prep. It's that pipeline that feeds this program. Line shot just on the line. Oh, called foul. Called foul. It looked like it was on the line. That was so, so close. So now the umpires getting together to discuss. That was so, so close. Coach Rebhan thought that that was a fair ball. And again, my angle, certainly not as good as the umpire standing on the line. If it missed, it missed just barely. Coach Gator thought he saw what I saw. But again, my angle is not nearly as good. Coach Rebhan was worried about bringing Bahadu around at third. He wasn't worried about fair and foul. So here we go. Two strikes on the batter. Dixon catches a break perhaps as Bahadu fouls off the 0-2. Panthers of FIU have had a solid year. Preseason picked sixth in the league, and here they are as the number two seed. Now 1-2 to Bahadu. This Panther team second in the Conference USA Eastern Division. Swept Louisiana Tech the last weekend of the series to earn that number two seed as Bahadu again tries to lay one just inside the left field line, but slices it foul. Marshall, preseason picked third in the league, did garner a first place vote. The regular season champions of a conference for the first time since they did it twice in the early 2000s. Their first ever time this year as a regular season champion in Conference USA. 1-2 fouled away again by Bahadu. Marshall right now, 23rd in the USA Today coaches poll. They're in a three-way tie for 24th with Ohio State and Tulsa in the ESPN.com USA softball poll. And they rank 26th, do the Thundering Herd, in the RPI. 1-2 pitch. And it's fouled away again. So right now these hitters so good. They are making these pitchers work. Denson for Marshall, Sale for the Panthers of FIU. Blooper into left. But with Estrada playing in, she puts it away. And there's two down. This Marshall team looking for their first championship in Conference USA since 2013, where they won the Conference USA tournament and punched their ticket. So back to the top of the order, and Jackie Schoaf. Schoaf takes a first pitch strike. Schoaf the infield single and the run scored in the first. Schoaf the sophomore batting 449. Check swing and the count evens. We mentioned that Marshall had three of the top players in terms of batting average in Conference USA, but coming into the tournament, well, FIU not too bad either. Choate, Teixeira, Leon, three of the top 13 hitters as a comebacker to Dixon, who whips it quickly to first in a 1-2-3 inning for the Panthers. So we go to the bottom of the second, still a 1-0 lead for FIU.
Rawlings is the official softball of Conference USA. Conference USA and its member institutions would like to thank Rawlings for their continued support throughout the season.
Allie Burdett leads things off with a foul tip strike to start the bottom of the second inning. Back here in Hattiesburg at the Southern Miss Softball Complex, I'm Josh West. It's a 1-0 lead for the Panthers as Burdett swipes and misses again. Burdett not in the starting lineup yesterday. Brianna Dice was, but Burdett came in after Dice had started the game 0-for-2 and ripped a double in the sixth. But swings and misses and is retired on three straight pitches here to lead off the bottom of the second inning. And so Burdett retired, and here comes Abigail Estrada. Estrada, the starting left fielder for the Thundering Herd. Estrada swings and misses as well. One of the best games this year for the sophomore was a 2-for-4 game with 3 RBI against WKU for the Herd's, part of the Herd's 23rd win of the season. Foul ball there by Estrada. Moves the count to 1-2. Estrada also not too bad defensively. Case in point, the game at Charlotte. First game of that series in Charlotte in the bottom of the seventh, where she recorded all three outs. Swings and misses here at the 1-2 rise ball from Sale. Sale now with 3 strikeouts through an inning and 2/3. And that bolsters her strikeout numbers now to 221 on the season. Now Jordan Cauliflower with 2 outs and the bases empty. Cauliflower late on the fastball, and it's 0-1. The junior bats 312 with a couple of homers, 3 triples, and 7 RBI. The rise ball evens the count out of the zone. Cauliflower out of Huntington, West Virginia. So a hometown product. Another big swing and a miss. And it's 1-2. And Sale, who was recruited mainly by Division II schools, wanted to pitch. The Division II schools weren't even recruiting her as a pitcher. But FIU gave her a chance, and the rest is history. And she blows another fastball past the Thundering Herd. Cauliflower's retired. Sale strikes out this side. 1-0. FIU through 2 in Hattiesburg.
see if your photo makes it on the official Conference USA Softball Championship Snapchat story.
Well, the sun makes an appearance for the first time today here in Hattiesburg. Should make for muggy conditions and warming temperatures. Our hope, though, is that it doesn't destabilize the atmosphere and lead to pop-up afternoon thunderstorms. Here is Jordan Dixon once again inside the circle for Marshall. And, oh, my goodness, high and tight to Ashley Leone. And she had to do her best rapid limbo there. Complete improv, and it worked. Leone the single and was stranded at third to end the first when the Panthers did play to run but left the bases loaded as the count now works even. Leone had an 0-for-3 day in game one, but that doesn't tell the whole story. As she takes ball two, Leone was still effective, reached on an error, also reached on a fielder's choice, and scored two runs. So she found ways to make it happen. Called strike on the curveball, and it's 2-2. FIU 13-4 in neutral site games this year. Marshall 14-1. Ground ball. Scooped it second near the bag, sliding as she was throwing was D'Orazio. Lost her footing after all the quick dry that was applied to the surface, but was able to get it to DeShields, who had the nice stretch, retired Leone by a step, and there's one away. There's so many numbers I throw out to you about these two teams that don't seem real. As to just how good these teams are, as to how close they are when you compare them statistically, as the pitch misses for ball one. The other crazy thing that kind of brings these two teams together was their win streaks this year. More on that after the 1-0. Two balls and no strikes now to Teixeira. Each team had a school record 17-game winning streak. Marshall broke their previous high of 14. FIU broke their previous high of 11, but it's even better. 2-0 misses, it's 3-0. Both teams had that winning streak snapped on April Fool's Day. Really? April Fool's Day? April 1st? For FIU, it was against FAU, the Owls. As there's a four-pitch walk to Teixeira, not surprising. Her 47th walk of this season. But for Marshall, it was right here in Hattiesburg against Southern Miss. Marshall would still, in that stretch, win 25 out of 26 ball games in a span of games from March 3rd to April 1st. And so here is Danny Mowry, who struck out swinging in the first. And a strike makes it nothing in one. So Teixeira at first with one out in the top of the third. The Panthers trying to grow a 1-0 lead. Dixon delivers another pitch fouled away, and it's nothing in two. Both D Dixon and Sale work extremely fast. O2 popped up. D'Orazio, a good look at her, having to shield her eyes and then made a root, what would have been a routine grab, maybe in overcast conditions. Was able to put it away, and here comes Cassandra Castle. And the sun just popped out. It was something that D'Orazio wasn't expecting. And it's very bright out here right now. And ball one to Castle. Castle, the designated player in this lineup, 265 hitter, with 5 home runs and 38 runs batted in. Well, our home plate umpire needed some more softballs. That gave McCord a chance to talk to Dixon. And we'll keep play moving here in the top of the third. Our second game today will pit Western Kentucky against Louisiana Tech in an elimination game. And a hit batter on the 1-0 delivery. That plucked Cassandra Castle. I thought I heard something. I wasn't sure. And it did indeed hit her. So a walk and a hit batter going back to the first. Dixon had a pair of walks. So the runner aboard at first. Jesse Rivera fouls back. The first pitch from Dixon, it's nothing and one. So runners at first and second. That's how quietly things can escalate between these two teams. Razor thin margin for error. Count evens now at 1-1. Rivera had the RBI single in the fourth of game one, went 1-for-3, also scored a run, also popped up to short and grounded out to short. 2 balls and a strike now to Rivera. And again, McCord is doing a lot of talking, encouraging Dixon, making sure she's locked in, but you can see it in the eyes of Dixon when you get a good look at her face. She's a young lady who is always, it appears, locked in. McCord was having to deal with the shin guard there. Ball three. Well, the Panthers are another ball away from loading the bases for the second time in 3 innings. Rise ball out of the zone, and Rivera walks. For the second time in as many plate appearances, Castle to second, Teixeira to third. Rivera drew a walk with the bases loaded on a payoff pitch in the first. And so here comes Sammy Green with the bases loaded. She gets a chance at a mulligan here. She popped up to short to end the first with the bases loaded. And the first pitch misses for ball one, so Dixon recorded just the second no-hitter in CUSA championship hit history yesterday, the third of her career, struggling a bit today with already 4 walks and a hit batter. And she delivers a strike there, and it's 1-1. The thing is, for Dixon, Dixon's only given up 1 hit out of the infield. Called strike. 1-2. So now Dixon, a strike away from stranding the bases loaded for the second time in 3 innings as time is called. And I believe that was, might have been called by McCord. Probably going to get a lot warmer today as the sun shines down on the wet surface, and a big rip at it by Green to foul it off. So we had a rain delay today of 3 hours and 32 minutes, just 92 minutes past our original start time when tournament week began. 1-2 outside, 2-2. McCord, the first team all-league catcher. This Marshall team second in the league and picking off runners trying to steal. 2-2 pitch, and again, Green fights off another pitch. Dixon closing in on 50 pitches today already through 2 2/3 innings. Pop up, and that one's going to get back to the net. Right when it was hit, McCord was hoping she'd have a chance at it. You'd be hard-pressed to imagine that the champion doesn't come out of this game right here. That's how good these two teams are playing. Hit well, into right field, but Cauliflower will put it away to end the inning. For the second time in three innings, the Panthers lead the bases loaded. Panthers up 1-0 as we go to the bottom of the third.
Whether on the field of play or in one of our local branches, InTouch Credit Union is always working for you and your financial well-being. InTouch is proud to be the official credit union for Conference USA, serving all student athletes and coaches at member schools. Visit itcu.org/CUSA for more information. For Marshall in the bottom of the third inning. Center fielder number 21, Eloise Triple A.
Eloise Triple A leads things off here in the bottom of the third inning in Hattiesburg. It's the winner's bracket of the Conference USA softball tournament. The one-seeded Marshall Thundering Herd, the 23rd ranked Herd against the number two-seeded Panthers. Shannon Sale delivers on the 1-0 pitch high, and it's 2-0. Was checking the radar in the break, and well, there's some severe storms that are building just north and west of Baton Rouge, where they had a tornado come through just east of there this morning. Tornado warnings through the New Orleans area, just south of New Orleans as well, which is a couple of hours south, and then maybe south and west of here if you're talking about Baton Rouge. 2-1 pitch missing, and it's 3-1. Then there's also storms on the I-55 corridor, which is a couple of hours to, well, maybe an hour and a half to our west. And then those storms on that 55 corridor to our north and west. As Triple A slaps away the 3-1, and the count runs full at 3-2. Triple A, the junior at 295 hitter, is also one of those players that has played in and started every game for Marshall. She tries to be a table setter. 27 runs scored, fifth best in the lineup today. A double and four RBI in the season. I mean, you've got Zirkel and D'Orazio and McCord following. You just want to get on base, and she does. Second walk of the day issued by Shannon Sale, and her counterpart, Jordan Dixon, has had four walks and a hit batter. These from the two pitchers, the only two pitchers in Conference USA, with sub-2 earned run averages. And so here is Morgan Zirkle. Zirkle swings away at the first pitch, and it's nothing and one. Well, it was quite the scene just a few weeks back as the entire team gathered together to see if their teammate Morgan Zirkle would get drafted. As the pitch is up and away, it's one and one. If you've ever been to Huntington, well, then you know about Fat Patty's, nestled on 3rd Avenue there in downtown. Well, with the final pick, 26th pick of the 2017 National Pro Fast Pitch Draft back on April 24th, Zirkle was picked up by the Scrapyard Dogs, based out of the Woodlands, Texas, just north of Houston. As Zirkle comes over and talking to her coach here with a 2-1 count, where the crowd just erupted, chanting with chants of, "We are Marshall, we are Marshall." And you can hear it. You've heard that fan base so many times, that proud fan base up there in Huntington. Nestled in the floodplain of the mountains there of West Virginia, right on the river. So I can't imagine what a neat moment that was for her, just the beginning of a busy summer. She'll also be a member of Team USA, and she's a special, special player. As a called strike moves the count to 2-2. Zirkle did not come to Hattiesburg when Marshall played Southern Miss. Had a mild concussion, and they wanted to make sure she was okay. 2-2 line drive, knocked down by Sale. She's going to have no chance. There are comebackers, and then there's that bullet that Sale almost was able to handle. But that might leave a mark. She might have some of the threads of the softball. Sharp comebacker, and Sale did everything she could to get there, but couldn't do it. And so an infield hit for Morgan Zirkle. For Zirkle, her 71st hit of the season. She had a solo home run, walked twice, scored 2 runs yesterday, and now Marshall is in business. Runners at first and second base. Tribele advances to second on that infield hit. Still no outs in the inning. And Alicia D'Orazio, who struck out swinging, the first of 4 strikeouts on the day for Sale so far at the plate. And she pops up a bunt, and it crawls back onto the net. Boy, the moment a coach sees a bunt popped up, the heart has to flutter, especially in this situation, especially since typically when Sale and Dixon go after each other, it's low scoring. D'Orazio lays down a beauty there, look to third, tries to come back to first, and not in time. So that was a miscue by Sale. Bases are now loaded with no outs. And Taylor McCord, the all-league catcher, coming to the plate. First pitch into McCord for ball one. Ball, no strikes. Right now it appears it's that she reached on the fielder's choice. Bases loaded is how it is scored. Taylor McCord now ahead in the count, 2 balls and no strikes. The Panthers clinging to the narrowest of leads. And the count now goes to 3-0. So the freshman from the frying pan into the fryer on a hot, muggy day in South Mississippi. Delivers a strike with McCord taking on 3-0. McCord, a 374 hitter. 52 hits, 11 doubles, 12 home runs, 50 RBI. 3-1, fouled straight back. McCord took a good rip at that one, didn't miss by much. Accord leads the team in home runs and RBI. Tied for second on the team in doubles with 11. The only player with more is Morgan Zirkle with 12, and then Braxton has 11 doubles as well. Another big rip by McCord and fouls it back. Well, she's gotten two good swings on the last couple of pitches by Sale. Well, what a difference an inning makes. A walk, an infield hit, a mental error after Sale struck out the side in the second inning. And again, McCord has the timing down against Sale. She's barely missing, and on three consecutive pitches. FIU got an RBI walk with the bases loaded by Rivera to play Schoaf, who reached on an infield single in the top of the first. Our only run so far, and again, four straight carbon copies by Taylor McCord of the Thundering Herd. McCord, top 25 in the country at 24th in RBI a game. Payoff pitch, popped up, and this will get out of play. An anxious moment. There's a good look at third base at Tribolet, who started off the inning with a walk. Well, the thoughts that have to be running through Sale's mind right now. She's got to stay in the rhythm. Stick with your routine. Try to stay loose. Keep the breathing patterns the same. Everything in rhythm. Payoff pitch, and again, McCord fouls it back. So we're getting right around 10 pitches. I want to go back and look at a long at bat this year for a Thundering Herd player, Brianna Dice, and their series clinching win against UAB. Had a 15 pitch at bat. Well hit into left field. Will this be deep enough to score a run? Throw, cut off, and a run scores on a sac fly. Tribolet comes in on the fly ball to Mowry in left, and we're tied at one. Throw was cut off that time by the third baseman Green. Zirkle stays put at second, DeRozio at first. But give McCord her 51st RBI of the season. If I'm not mistaken, second in the league in RBI behind Teixeira of FIU. So Marshall able to answer that run by the Panthers as Shaylin Braxton, who doubled in the first, is at the plate. Doubled off the glove of Green. It ricocheted into foul territory. Green playing over at third, of course. Ball two. Mowry in left, Schoaf in center, Bahadu in right, Green at third, Rivera at short, Leon at second, Teixeira at first, and Gilbert behind the plate. 2-0 pitch high, and it's 3-0. Shaylin Braxton now could, with a walk, load the bases. And a game knotted up at one. And there's ball four. So a four-pitch walk. Second walk of the inning, third of the game for Sale. DeRozio to second, Zirkle to third. Elizabeth DeShields is at the plate. She flew out to center field to end the first. If she flies out there deep enough, it could give the Thundering Herd the lead, but she's not thinking about that. She's thinking about all that room perhaps in right center field. Swings and misses at an all-speed pitch there. That was too good to lay off of. DeShields, the freshman, backs 309. Pitch outside. And it's 1-1. each team with a run now on two hits. The Herd do have an error in right field. Zirkle at third, D'Orazio at second, Braxton at first, and the pitch in for a strike, and the count moves to 1-2. It feels like it's warming up dramatically here in Hattiesburg. That could help the ball carry just a little bit, but the air is thick. Pop up, foul ground, and running out of real estate that time was Teixeira, and she went right into the railing on the first base side. Count stays at 1-2. One-two pitch snagged nicely by Gilbert. That might have saved a run. The speedy Zirkle at third, waiting to take off. Bases loaded with one out. And the Herd threatening. Not only have they tied this game, poised to take the lead. 2-2 low. 3-2. Now to Shields. There's a lot of ways that you can make it happen here. Ground ball, fly ball. Draw bases loaded, walk and drive in a run. Would be her 11th of the year. She's sitting at 10 RBI at the moment. Payoff pitch, hit well, hooking foul, and that was creamed some 200 plus feet beyond home plate, but about 30 feet wide of the left field foul pole. That was crushed. So DeShields got the pitch she was looking for, just was a little early. As Shields fights off another pitch. We are seeing great battle after great battle here today. As these hitters are locked in. They got here early this morning. They were here at 9 o'clock this morning and had been here preparing for a 10 a.m. start. The game time got moved back to 12:15. Then bump back to 1, then bump back to 1:30. So they have been waiting all day to play this game. Good look there of D'Orazio at second base. And now it looks like Sale's going to get a new softball. Certainly a much more pleasant day. You see the fans that were hiding from the sunshine a couple of days ago. They were finding what little shade there is here right in front of the press box just off screen. Today, they're welcoming the sun. It's a little bit cooler. Temperatures in the mid-70s to upper 70s at the moment. Payoff pitch is hit to first. Throw coming home for the home for the force. Back to first for the double play. Teixeira to Gilbert. To Leon, the second baseman, covering, and only one run for Marshall in the third. Tied at one as we go to the fourth here in Hattiesburg.
Fans, Conference USA would like to thank Event One for providing the merchandise available to our fans during Conference USA Softball Championship. Please be sure to visit our merchandise table located near the entrance to the stadium. Merchandise will be available throughout the championship.
Julia Gilbert to lead things off. Here in the top of the fourth inning, Panthers got to be feeling pretty good that they did not surrender the lead entirely. Yes, it's a tie ball game, but they could have found themselves well in a hole. That's what I was really meaning to say. Yes, the lead was surrendered, but they're not behind. Gilbert popped up in foul territory over third base to lead off the second inning. Jordan Dixon spinning it well inside the circle. Despite the four walks and a hit, batter has only given up one hit outside of the infield. Pop up into the stands. The count evens at 2-2. Gilbert, the sophomore out of Rialto, California. Two-two, popped up, foul ground. Easy play that time by Braxton. And so twice now, Gilbert has popped up in foul ground to Braxton. Almost identical spots, I mean, very, very close. So here is Brianna Bahadu. The nine-hole hitter flew out to left field for the second out of inning number two. First pitch strike to Bahadu, and it's nothing in one. Bahadu so far 0-for-3 with a walk in this tournament after an 0-for-2 day yesterday. Lines it to right, and it hangs up for Cauliflower, who had it played beautifully. Just was smoothly moving in on that one. The line out to right field. And Bahadu is retired. Jackie Schoaf now coming to the plate. Schoaf, the infield single, and the run scored in the first. And then on a 1-3 put out in the second, back to the circle to end that inning. She'll lift it into left field, racing in, diving, and in foul ground, losing it and kind of rolling up her wrist that time was Estrada, and you hope she's okay. Estrada pops up a little gimpy, and she's holding her right elbow perhaps. Kind of right elbow, right shoulder. There you see just team trainers running over just to make sure it's okay, just to make sure everything is as it should be. But she has made some incredible diving plays. And honestly, every time she goes after a softball, you think she's going to get it. This Marshall program, their 12th 30-win season. Again, we said they're first Conference USA regular season title, having picked up a couple of MAC championships in the mid to early 2000s. It is tender. Boy, and that's how fast it can happen. You hear coaches talk all the time about play every game all out. Play every game like it's your last. You don't know, you're not guaranteed tomorrow. Nothing's guaranteed. And you hear all of these cliches, and then we're just rocking right along with two outs here in the fourth, and what appeared to be just another spectacular play was going to be made by Estrada, as it turned out in foul territory. And then Estrada gets banged up just a little bit, but it appears she's going to be okay. She just needs a little ice and a good rub down, it appears. That's what we hope for her and her teammates. You see the entire rest of the herd squad meeting with Dixon inside this circle. They're just trying to stay loose. They're trying to still stay in their mindset. Certainly they're concerned about Estrada, but it appears at the moment that she's going to be okay. She's got some, maybe a little bit of tingling there in that right arm. And let's see if she is indeed coming out. It appears for the moment that she is. And it appears that Marshall is going to bring in Maddie Marshall, the utility player out of St. Albans, West Virginia, into the ballgame. So they'll make a move here and put Cauliflower over to left and then bring in Marshall over to right field. So some things shift up just a little bit. Tribole still in center. Braxton at third, circle at short. D'Orazio at second. DeShields at first. McCord behind the plate. And I do hope we see Estrada again. Hopefully she'll be able to go through some stretching exercises and maybe if need be get a little ice. If it goes the ice route, though, you wonder if we'll see her again in this game. She got banged up pretty good. But the all-out effort that you see from these teams chasing a championship, that was championship effort level hustle play that time by Estrada, and that's what you're looking for. Game one of what we hope to be three today. We could be in for a long day here at the ballpark. We're hoping that the clouds can stay with us and keep the temperatures cool as much as possible on this Friday. Graduation day here on the Southern Miss campus. They had commencement at 9 a.m. and then 3 p.m. So a tough day to navigate traffic in Hattiesburg. Tough day to find a restaurant to eat dinner at this evening. And then, of course, having the best of the best in Conference USA softball in town in one of the most underrated softball leagues in the country in Conference USA. As Jackie Schoaf falls behind in the count now after another foul ball and nothing in two. Conference USA at one point this year had as many as, if I'm not mistaken, nine teams. I know it was eight with nine sometimes right there hovering on the bubble of top 100 RPI teams. 0-2 pitch popped up into center field and Tribole barely has to move. The fly ball to center ends the inning. We're halfway through this one between the Panthers and the Thundering Herd. We've decided nothing. We're tied at one here in Hattiesburg. Maddie Marshall leads things off here in the Thundering Herd, bottom of the fourth inning in a tie game at one. Working against Shannon Sale. Hey, 2-0 pitch in for a strike. Estrada, I believe, due up second this inning. Swing and a miss. And it's 2-2. Two balls and two strikes. 3-2 now, count is full. Marshall, a 200 hitter coming into this tournament, with 8 hits, a couple of runs batted in. Pop up will find its way into the bleachers. Count remains full. Allie Burdett had struck out swinging in the second. Payoff pitch right down the middle. Freezing Marshall looking. Fifth strikeout of the day for Shannon Sale. And strikeout number 223 of the season for her.
Hayden Ellis.
And so here comes Ellis now. Hayden Ellis, the sophomore catcher on the roster, hitting in the spot of Estrada here. And a strike there to Ellis. Ellis came in yesterday in the sixth and lined out to center field. Pitch low, count evens at 1-1. For Ellis, 128 hitter on the season entering the tournament with 6 hits, 3 doubles, and 4 runs batted in. Big swing and a miss on that patented Sale rise ball. She is so good at that pitch. Ball two, strikes the 1-2. Called strike three, freezes Ellis looking. Back-to-back strikeouts here in the fourth for Sale, both looking. And you remember, Sale struck out the side of Thundering Herd in the second. Here's Jordan Cauliflower. Cauliflower started the game in right field for just that final out in the top of this fourth inning. Moved to left after Estrada banged up her right shoulder. 1-0 the count to Cauliflower. Again, struck out swinging in the second, so trying to avoid being the strikeout victim to end the inning for the second time today. 2-0 pitch, finds the zone. 2-1. Back in Hattiesburg, Mississippi, this tournament for the first time since 2000, as Cauliflower swings and misses. First ever conference tournament was at Optimus Park. And so it's come full circle since that first year at the turn of the century. 2-2 pitch that misses for ball three. Count is full and a tie game at one. Sale cruising here in the bottom of the fourth. Called strike three on the outside corner. Freezes Cauliflower. And the Herd go down looking, and the side is retired by the strikeout. Through four, we're tied at one here in Hattiesburg. Josh West back here with you at the Southern Miss Softball Complex. We're tied at one here in Hattiesburg, winner's bracket game of the Conference USA Tournament on Game 3. Our first game today after a 3-hour, 32-minute weather delay due to rain that moved through the area. About an inch of rain, and it unfortunately looks like thunderstorms are building off to our west once again. Could be here in a couple of hours, so it's going to be a long day here, but boy, what a great place to be, and with great people watching great softball. Here's Dixon, and she deals a strike. It's Leon Teixeira Mowry. Meat of the order. 2-3-4 hitters. Leon 1-for-2 with a single. Takes another strike. For whatever reason, just kind of looking at the rhythm, reading the body language, whatever maybe was ailing Dixon a little bit early, doesn't appear to be the case right now. Coach Revhan is over to talk to our home plate umpire. And as they discuss something here, Ashley Leon will be behind in the count, no balls and two strikes. Coach Revhan wanted a call down the left field line earlier that he did not get. And so he's not extremely animated here, but he's certainly making a point. Stephanie Teixeira, who is on deck, has walked twice. Danny Mowry is 0-for-2. Just one substantial hit off of Dixon today for the FIU Panthers, who entered this tournament. The team batting average of .291 as Leon fights off the 0-2 pitch. Louisiana Tech will be taking on Western Kentucky in a win-or-go-home game, about 30 minutes or so after this one is final. And going after a rise ball again, Leon. Well, now that was a swing up around the eyes. Those were pitches that I would swing at in my illustrious Little League career that lasted, I believe, a whole 15 games in 1 year. 0-2 pitch again, fouled away by Leon. Yeah, my baseball career, 15 games, one season. I didn't decide to play until later. And then I knew that basketball was my thing. But then golf, the ball sits still. So I have a little better chance of hitting it. Not much, but a little. These ladies are special. That round bat, that round ball. 0-2. It's up high, a ball and two strikes. Dixon is throwing extremely hard today. Marshall looking for their 42nd win of the season. Pop up, slicing into the stands. And a nice grab that time by a Louisiana Tech fan. Off a ricochet off the short hop. One, two, check swing, crowd wanted, and the Marshall infield wanted strike three, but they didn't get it. 2-2. Two strikeouts, four walks, and a hit batter today for Marshall's Jordan Dixon. Lifted into right field, and making the play out in right field is Marshall for the first out. So one away here in the top of the fifth for the Panthers. Panthers a record now of 44-12. Again, their strength of schedule was knocked this year, but I'm going to read you some of the teams that they scheduled, played, and beat who might not have had the season that they expected to have as Teixeira sees ball one. Would not be surprised to see Teixeira walked again here with the bases empty here in the fifth. There's a strike and it's 1-1. FIU with a pair of wins over Memphis, three wins over Georgetown, a win over Maryland, two wins over Rutgers, a win over Boston College, Kansas, three over Florida Gulf Coast. They also played Florida and lost 5-0 back on February 19th. I mean, they have played some teams. Those were just some of the notable wins for this Panther team, but just it's mind-boggling to me that they're on the bubble. 2-1 is lined fair down the right field line. Teixeira rounds first, heading to second, standing up with a double. So Teixeira comes through again, doubles down the right field line. And for Teixeira, that's her eighth double of the season. She just continues her tear. And here is Danny Mowry. Mowry's 0 for 2. Struck out swinging in the first, popped up to second in the third. Teixeira is oh so dangerous. Big swing there by Mowry to fall behind nothing and one. Another big swing and a miss, and it's nothing in two. Mowry, the senior, batting 302, nine doubles, a triple, six home runs. Runner at second, one out. It's hit on the nose into left field. That's trouble. That's over the head of the left fielder, over Cauliflower. Teixeira will easily score. A stand-up RBI double ripped by Danny Mowry. Her 10th double of the season, her 33rd RBI, and the Panthers have retaken the lead 2-1 here in the top of the fifth. That is back-to-back doubles. Hugging the right field line the opposite way into left. Over Cauliflower. And the Panthers back on top. Panthers now with two runs on four hits. The Herd, a run on two hits. Here's Cassandra Castle. She lines it, and it ricochets off the mitt of D'Orazio at second base, who popped up quickly to make sure that Mowry stayed put. That was a sharply hit ball. And it ricocheted off the mitt of D'Orazio, who was playing deep in the hole at second base. And so Marshall now going to call time, come into this circle to talk about the situation that they have put themselves into. D'Orazio tried to make the play. It's going to go down as a single for Castle. Runners at first and second. Back-to-back-to-back hits. Such an electrifying stretch for Panther fans, considering they had two hits through four innings. Those were the first two batters of the ball game. Coming into this inning, they had only one hit out of the infield. After the flyout to right by Leone, back-to-back doubles, the second and RBI double by Mowry to score Teixeira, and then a single by Castle. So runners at first and second, more hits in this three-batter stretch to Teixeira, Mowry, Castle than the first four innings combined. So the Panthers up 2-1. Jessica Rivera has walked twice, brought in a run and an RBI walk with the bases loaded in the first. Feel the intensity picking up a little bit. You can feel the pressure building. Jordan Dixon really appears to be no worse for the wear as the Panthers bring in a pair of pinch runners at first and second. It's Peralta at second base. Sully Peralta, and then Devin Kennedy is at first base. The pitch, well outside, throw up to second, nearly a pickoff. My goodness, the cannon that hangs from the right shoulder of McCord. She uncorked a bullet to second that nearly picked off Peralta on the throw behind her at second base. Foul ball, out of play. And it's 1-2. You can also feel a little bit of a changing mood here inside the stadium. It's getting a little more real, a little more serious for the fans. We're getting into the latter innings here in the top of the fifth. Marshall had tied the game. The Panthers come back and immediately answer. Big swing and a miss. And Rivera retired on another beautiful pitch by Dixon. For Dixon, her third strikeout of the day. One thing's for certain, Dixon's not going to back down. Dixon looking for her 32nd win of the season today. First pitch misses for a ball to Sammy Green. Green has popped up to short, flown out to right. Pitch right down the heart of the plate for a strike, and it's 1-1. Dixon first in the league in appearances. This is her 45th of this season. Tops in wins with 31 in the league as Green fouls away the 1-1 pitch. It's 1-2. Seventh in the country in strikeouts, second in the country in wins. First in innings pitched. On and on and on the accolades we can heap on this lady, and they're deserved as the 1-2 is fouled back and away. Runners at first and second, two outs. Lifted into left center field where Tribole will put it away, but a run comes in to score on three hits, no errors, two left. Panthers retake the lead for the Conference USA Softball Championship in Hattiesburg. Well, the sun is out here in Hattiesburg. You would never know that we had over an inch of rain and a line of severe storms that moved through the area this morning that actually spawned tornadoes in Louisiana. The first pitch strike comes in to Eloise Tribole, who recorded the last out, got the put out to end the top of the fifth inning. Tribole, Zirkle, and then D'Orazio to begin things here in the bottom of the fifth against Shannon Sale, Conference USA's freshman of the year. I'm Josh West. Happy to have you with us here on this Friday afternoon. It's commencement day here at Southern Miss. So a lot of people in town. There's been some very enthusiastic crowds. I think the crowds and the teams have really enjoyed being here in Hattiesburg this week so far. Here's the pitch. And it misses, and the count evens at 2-2. Tribele walked and has scored the Herd's only run. That came in the third. Tribele also went 1-for-2 in the win over Western Kentucky as she lines out to short to Rivera, who had it played perfectly, was played in. The entire infield was pinched in. And the line out to short is the first out of the fifth and at the top of the order in Morgan Zirkel. Zirkel went yard to lead off the third in yesterday's win. It was a solo shot deep to left center. Was absolutely creamed. She's also popped up to third in foul territory today. Did that to lead off the first. And for a strike, the count moves to 1-1. A run in the first. One again in the top of the fifth for the Panthers. A run in the bottom of the third, again, as we mentioned, for the Thundering Herd. And as the 1-1 just misses, it's 2-1. You've got to nibble at these pitchers. You're going to get some base runners. It's all about that timely hitting. You're not just going to beat up on Dixon or Sale. Zirkel got a piece of the 2-1 offering. The count goes to 2-2. It was a healthy swing by Morgan Zirkel. Two-two pitch, hit towards short, got under the glove of Rivera for a base hit. So Zirkel gets her second hit of the ball game. She's got two of the three hits by Marshall. Now this is where it gets interesting. Marshall went 3-for-4 on the base paths yesterday. Marshall as a team, 155 stolen bases in 184 attempts, and a fly ball first pitch by D'Orazio, retired by Mowry and left. Well, that all happened quickly. I didn't expect that. I don't think you did back at home either. Marshall, a team that leads the country in stolen bases at just under 3.17 a game now. They had 3-for-4 yesterday. Then Zirkel, 8 in the country in the stolen base department coming into this tournament. She looked like there she was taking off, but it's ball one. Gilbert had an eye on Zirkel. Taylor McCord at the plate. McCord popped up over and landed right on top of the press box here. And it's 1-1. McCord walked in the first, had a sac fly to bring in Tribele in the third. Herd have left a pair of runners stranded in the first and the third innings. Popped up just behind the cutout. Rivera puts it away, and it was a busy, busy inning for Rivera. The pop-up to short ends the inning. No runs on a hit, no errors, one left. Five complete, 2-1 lead for the Panthers of FIU.
For 50 years, FIU has been serving a community that's seeking something different from its university. From the sawgrass of the Everglades to the boardrooms of downtown, Miami is a modern, global city built with an entrepreneurial spirit that's always looking forward. A city that moves at this speed requires a public research university to support it. And that's what we've been building at FIU since 1965. A locally engaged, globally connected university.
I am ready to do all that I can. I can reach new heights, go farther than I have. I am a son. I am a daughter of Marshall. I am driven to succeed, skilled and destined to lead. I'm part of a community, even more than that, a family. I am motivated to make it, to show the world all I can be. I am a son, I am a daughter, of Marshall.
Good chance to hear from FIU and Marshall and about the great things they have going on their great campuses. So many great institutions that make up the league in Conference USA, very diverse league, stretching from into Virginia all the way into the desert of El Paso, into the mountains of the desert of El Paso, Texas. And so as we move to the top of the sixth inning, it will be the bottom of the Panther order coming up here. So the Panthers are going to lead it off here with, I believe, a pinch hitter. Kayla Mills, the junior out of Hastings, Minnesota, is going to come up here to pinch hit for Julia Gilbert. Mills sneaks in on us here a little bit. We'll set her up for you. Mills batting 400 on the year and takes a pitch up and in. Mills, though, has only had five at-bats, but has scored eight runs. He's primarily as a pinch runner. A couple of hits on this season. 2-for-5. Takes a strike and the count evens at 1-1. And Julia Gilbert had popped up in foul territory to third in the second and the fourth. That was enough for Coach Repham to make a change. Swing and a miss there by Mills, and it's 1-2. Mills, Bahadu, and Schoaf. Eight, 9-1 here in the top of the sixth. And a pop-up straight up the chute. And a nice play by McCord. Didn't have time to shed the mask that time. Might have helped her, though, to have the mask on to shield the sun. So something about that eight spot in the lineup that has just not been friendly to the Panthers. Bahadu has flown out to left, has lined out to right. Starting right fielder stands in with the bases empty, one out. Takes a strike. Bahadu, 253 hitting freshman coming into today with 21 hits and a couple of RBI. And fouls off the 0-1 pitch and falls behind in an 0-2 hole. Panthers would love to take a run at Dixon with some base runners on and then the top of the lineup coming up. Slapped away by Bahadu, protecting the plate there. Most earned runs surrendered by Dixon this year against FAU was in that game two where she worked three innings and gave up two runs both earned on three hits with a couple of strikeouts and a walk. That was a no decision. Kaylee Williamson took the loss in that ball game. Slap to short, scoop there, and the throw by Zirkle to Shields for the second out. And so back to the top of the order and Jackie Schoaf. Right now the two-seeded Panthers leading the one-seeded Marshall Thundering Herd, and well, the score right now is their seeds. 2-1. With two outs in the top of the sixth. Dixon deals. And a ground ball base hit by Schoaf, her second hit of the ballgame. Had an infield single, scored a run in the first, comes through after a ground out and a fly out to single here in the sixth. And there's hope now for Panther fans in a one out rally. Or rather, a two-out rally with that one-base knock. And so here's Ashley Leone. Leone 1-for-3 with a single. Grounded out to second and the third. Flew out to right in the fifth. Pitch on the way from Dixon. And misses low for ball one. 1-0, high. Two balls and no strikes. Anytime you are coming off a no-hit performance, it's tough to follow that up. However, although we know where best is and it's high, here's the 2-0. Strike called, it's 2-1. Even though she's not maybe at her perfect best, she's close. Her worst is better than most. Here's the pitch. And it's lifted into right field. Hit pretty good, but Marshall has a beat on it, puts it away. Maddie Marshall retires the last out for the Herd. No runs on a hit, no errors, one left. Nine stranded through six for the Panthers, who lead it 2-1, going to the bottom of the sixth inning. Thanks for watching the 2017 Conference USA Softball Championships from Hattiesburg, Mississippi on BN Sports. Don't forget to tune in weekdays as Sean Salisbury and his bench warmers discuss hot topics in sports. Will the Cavaliers and the Warriors meet again in the NBA Finals? Who will take Lord Stanley's Cup this summer? Every weekday starting at 5 p.m. Eastern, 2 p.m. Pacific, only on BN Sports. Shaylin Braxton leading things off here in the bottom of the sixth inning for the Herd. It took Marshall three frames to tie the game at one, and then back in the fifth, the Panthers retake the lead. Braxton to Shields, Burdett. Perhaps up here in the sixth as Marshall hit in that six hole in the fourth. And the count is now 2-1 to Shaylin Braxton. Braxton doubled in the first, walked in the third. Big swing and a miss. Braxton swinging for the fences there, and it's 2-2. A pitch that Sale wanted, she doesn't get, and the count is full at 3-2. Payoff pitch, and it's now ball four. So there were two pitches at the end of that at bat. Shannon Sale wanted both of them. Instead, she walks Braxton for the second time today. It's her fourth walk of the day overall, but she struck out the side swinging in the second, struck out the side looking in the fourth. That has gone a long way in to help keep her, keeping her pitch count down and help give her a lot of confidence today. So a brief meeting with the sun out right now. It's a nice thing. It's drying up the field quickly. And then also the chance of maybe another little cell that could pass through and give us a brief delay. You want this field to dry up as much as possible. In between now and then. Here is Elizabeth DeShields. DeShields stands in, ready to go. Pitch comes in at DeShields, and she pushes that bunt foul. DeShields grounded to first, part of a 3-2-4 double play to end the third inning when the bases were loaded. Marshall only got one run to tie the game in the third. It could have been so much more because they tied the game with the bases loaded, one out. So with a runner at first base, being Braxton. We see a big time huddle here. Every pitch, every swing, every out, every inning of the utmost importance. And that's why we've seen a couple of more timeouts, a couple of more meetings, a couple of more huddles than usual. They know what's on the line. You can get all the box scores, get all the action from this tournament, all the recaps and quotes at ConferenceUSA.com. You can follow the league on Twitter, at ConferenceUSA. As the bunt attempt misses there by DeShields, and the count goes to 1-1. DeShields had the double play in the third, also flew out to center field in the first, but the freshman has had sparkling numbers for the year as a whole, a 309 hitter. DeShields, the freshman out of Midwest City, Oklahoma. So the count now moves to two strikes on DeShields. No balls, two strikes. Now 1-2. Braxton at first after the walk. Ground ball hit to short, could be two. Flipped to second for one. On to first, double play. And just like that, there are two outs in the inning. Rivera started it. Leon covered quickly and turns it to DeShera. There's two away on the 6-4-3 twin killing. So we watch it again. So smooth on the flip. And then the turn is what did it. Leon got the shoulders turned quickly. Second double play that DeShields is grounded into today. A more unconventional double play in the third, 3-2-4. And then the 6-4-3 double play here in the sixth, and that completely changes the complexion of the inning. As here comes Allie Burdett back into the ballgame after Marshall pinch hit for her in the fourth, struck out looking. Burdett is also 0-for-1. She struck out swinging in the second inning. This Panther team, they lead Conference USA in ERA at 1.79. Opponents bat just 200 against the Panthers. And a first pitch strike into Burdett. Three of the top eight pitchers in this league are on this Panther roster. Sale with a 1.41 ERA, Kugelman with a 2.06 ERA, and Summers with a 2.20 earned run average. One ball and a strike now to Allie Burdett. The 1-1, swing and a miss. Burdett went chasing on that rise ball. Sale already with seven strikeouts on the day. Count evens now at 2-2. Let's not go to sleep as well on this FIU defense. Came in as the best in the league in terms of fielding percentage, only 36 errors. And Panthers going to have to play a little bit more defense in this inning as they surrender a two-out single ripped back up the middle by Allie Burdett, her second hit of this Conference USA tournament. She had the double yesterday in the win over Western Kentucky. This one was crushed. So here is at the plate for the herd. It's Ellis flying to center to end the inning. No runs on a hit, no errors. One left on base to the seventh we go. Panthers clean to a 2-1 lead in Hattiesburg. 14th meeting all time between the Marshall Thundering Herd and the Panthers of FIU. And it's another classic matchup between these two teams this year. It was a 2-1 win for Marshall over FIU in Miami back on April 14th. Here, Panthers trying to turn the tables. They lead it 2-1. Going to the top of the seventh, looking for some insurance runs, and they work against Teixeira, who doubled and scored in the fifth. She works ahead in the count of ball and no strikes. Teixeira has also walked twice. 1-0 pitch, and it's outside 2-0. Teixeira just owning the record books at FIU. All-time record for batting average, slugging percentage, on base percentage, runs, homers, RBI, walks, putouts. And she's also chasing the hits record, the doubles record, and more. For Teixeira, though, the senior running out of just the volume of games to do so, but my goodness, she will be in that record book, you'd have to think, as long as there is one. With a 2-0 count to Teixeira, the discussion right now is you got to be very careful. So Teixeira steps back in, leading things off in the seventh. 3-0 now to Teixeira. It's a Panther team that coming into this week had not won a game in the Conference USA tournament ever. Just 0-2. So they're trying to get that record back to 500. Time call. FIU 4-9 all time against Marshall. 0-1 in neutral site games. Teixeira jammed, hits it on a short hop to second, throw to first. In time, a spectacular play by D'Orazio at second base. Beautiful. To field it on the short hop, it was all the muscle of Teixeira to get it out there. And then D'Orazio going down on her knees to make the throw. Tremendous. Here's Peralta at the plate as a pinch hitter. Sully Peralta, the junior out of Tucson, Arizona. Peralta, 212 hitter. One-oh pitch, curveball inside, 2-0. Peralta on the year, 21 hits, a double. As yet to drive in a run, has walked 12 times. And now the count is quickly to 3-0. With the count where it is, you want to look at those stolen base numbers, and Peralta 5 out of 7 in the stolen base department. As a team, FIU 79 of 92. Only caught stealing 13 times, and a strike dealt to Peralta, with Peralta taking all the way. Bases empty, one out here on the top of the seventh inning. Pop up, that gets into the stands, and the count runs full. Cassandra Castle, the designated player, will be next. She's got a hit and has also reached after being hit by a pitch. So she's hit the ball, and it's hit her. 3-2. It's golf foul again. My slice isn't quite that bad, although the golf ball isn't coming towards me at 70 miles an hour either with spin. Three balls, two strikes. It's amazing the growth and popularity of the women's game. 3-2. And again, another foul ball as Peralta making Dixon work. I don't have an update on the pitch count. My monitor has been down for a while. Three balls, two strikes. Full count pitch again. Peralta pops it up. Foul territory, reaching up and just running out of real estate at the steps that time was Braxton. And so Peralta will get another swipe at it. Dixon has thrown a lot of pitches so far, over 120 so far today. And again, thanks to Jordan, one of our producers, and Chris and the entire crew, they've done a phenomenal job to make it look and sound good. Line shot through the wickets that time of Dixon and into center field. Now that is something you don't see very often, but I'm sure we'll get to see it again. And it's worth a second look. Peralta comes through with a one-out single. And she's dabbing in celebration. Right through the legs of Dixon. Dixon didn't expect that to be coming right back at her. Thought she had made a really good pitch and relaxed just a little bit to kind of watch the play. And then all of a sudden it was coming right back and then right underneath her into center field. Here's Cassandra Castle. She rips the first pitch into the bullpen, where Western Kentucky, a couple of their players and coaches out getting loose. Well, more so than getting loose, just kind of standing around and visiting on what has turned out to be a beautiful, beautiful Friday afternoon for the moment. 0-1, and the count evens. Castle struck out swinging in the first, hit by a pitch in the third, and then singled in the fifth. Ooh, it comes in and it hits Castle. That was a curveball that got away early from Dixon. That one stung. Second time in the ballgame that Castle has been hit by a pitch. That one, though, right on the elbow protector. That's why they wear those. It allows them to stay in and take those pitches. So Castle is at first base. Peralta now at second base. And now it's over 128 pitches.
Now batting number seven,
the count.
Jessica Rivera.
Pitch comes in. Rivera hits a gapper. That one heads on a one hop to the wall. Throw, the relay comes in. Not in time. They'll hold it at the cutoff. Two runs will score. A two RBI double by Jessica Rivera, her second and third RBI of the day, and the lead is tripled for the Panthers here on the top of the seventh. And you'll wonder if Dixon isn't losing just a little bit of steam. A two RBI double. It's now 4-1 FIU. Peralta scores from second. Castle blazes around all the way to score from third. And that one, when it one-hopped the fence, you knew it was trouble when it left the bat. So now Rivera at second base, and Sammy Green is at the plate. If you're a Panther fan, you're breathing a little bit easier because you know Zirkle is batting third in the seventh, and then D'Orazio McCord follow. You wanted to have some insurance runs. You've got a pair so far. Dixon trying to regroup. Delivers a strike, and it's 1-1. Green popped up to short in the first, flew out to right in the third. Just now, we see that Allie Burdett is going to loosen a little bit in that Marshall Thundering Herd bullpen. As Green, that foul ball moves the count to 1-2. But a runner at second base now, still one out in the top of the seventh inning. Pop up here to Green, coming in to make the catch. DeShields crashing into McCord. DeShields never heard McCord call her off, and it was as if she looked down at the last moment and then just kind of dropped to her knees and then just kind of hugged the lower body of McCord, not to create a violent collision. It's as if right in her bottom periphery, she saw McCord at the last moment. Disaster avoided. Deep sigh of relief for Marshall fans as we watch it again. Now watch this. Right at the last moment, it appears as if she saw McCord and checked up just a little bit. That could have been ugly. It also could have been ugly if DeShield had crashed into the outside of the legs of McCord, because then knees and ankles become involved. At the plate is Gilbert. She'll bloop out to second to DeRozio to end the inning. But in the inning, it's two runs off two hits, and there were no errors and one left. To the bottom of the seventh we go. FIU a three-run lead. Marshall's last chance when we return. Well, if you're the Marshall Thundering herd right now as we go to the bottom of the seventh inning, you've got to quote Jim Carrey in his great role as Lloyd in Dumb and Dumber. So you're telling me there's a chance. Down three outs of wiggle room in the bottom of the seventh, and you've got your all-everything shortstop batting third in Morgan Zirkle. So it'll be the 8, 9, and 1 hitters due up. But we'll go to immediately to a pinch hitter. This will be Brianna Dice coming up here for Marshall. And Dice takes ball one. Cauliflower had been 0 for 2 with a strikeout swinging and a strikeout looking. And Dice fouls straight back the 1-0 fastball, and it's 1-1. This has been exactly what we thought it would be. The only difference, FIU has had a couple of clutch hits. They have out hit the herd 8-4. And Dice fouls back another pitch that came in with a lot of velocity. Classic look there, the uniforms, the old gold, the Vegas gold on the navy blue of FIU. As a pitch in the dirt evens the count at 2 balls and 2 strikes. Boy, it certainly looks like that Sale has a little more bounce in her step. Maybe that's just something I'm trying to read into it, but she seems to be bouncing around a little more. A pop-up here, calling everybody off and making the play is Rivera. And so Dice is retired on the pop-up. One away here in the seventh. And here comes Eloise Tribole. Tribole is 0 for 1, a line out to short. Has also walked and scored the Herd's only run of the game. Here's the pitch, and Tribole swings and misses and ricochets off the face mask of the catcher, Gilbert. And it's nothing in one. Coming up about 30, 35 minutes or so after this ball game, it'll be Louisiana Tech and Western Kentucky in an elimination game. And there's a strike, and it's nothing in two. That was pitch number 130. For Sale. Both Dixon and Sale have been locked in. The rise ball, swing and a miss. And Sale again, the numbers coming into today, they bear repeating. She's on the brink of going 9-0 with two saves in her last 11 games. And she's only surrendered 22 hits in her last 11, an average of two a game. Her strikeout total now, with eight today, is up to 73 in the last 11. Opponents batting only 105. She had a .12 ERA coming into today in their last 10. Swing and a miss here by Zirkle. And Sale is one pitch away from seeing the Panthers push on to the next round. 0-2 pitch is up high. Zirkle was not chasing. Zirkle has had two of the four third hits today. She's just trying to extend. Swing and a miss on the rise ball. Nine strikeouts on the day for Sale. And that strikeout sends the Panthers to the next round. So they move forward. They advance. And they advance into the championship game. FIU win number 45 today. Sale gets win number 19. And there you see the big two runs of insurance in the seventh that took all the suspense out of the bottom of the seventh inning. Sale struck out the side, swinging in the second, struck out the side looking in the fourth. And we're just waiting for Coach Repham to join our very own Maddie Morris, who is standing by on the field, waiting to talk to the winning coach, who has just witnessed his team pick up win number 45. Marshall loses for just the ninth time this year, but they fall to 1-3 this season against the Panthers. Boy, what a great look inside that FIU dugout. Well, that look tells you everything you need to know. Incredible scene of celebration as their one went away from a championship. Maddie Morris is standing by with Coach Repham, and we'll send it down in just a moment to Maddie.
Here with Coach Gator Raven. Coach, you guys came in, it was going to be a pitcher's duel, you know, obviously with Jordan Dixon and Sales for you guys. How do you think you guys were able to handle Jordan Dixon this game?
I mean, the girls have stepped up and got the hits when they needed to. Dixon's a great pitcher. Shannon and Dixon pitching against each other, you know it's going to be a low-scoring game. And, you know, Jesse came up at the end with that big hit at the end that opened it up for us, made us feel a lot better at the end.
What does it mean kind of being able to get on the board first in today's game?
Means a lot, especially against Marshall. Marshall's a scrappy team. You know they're going to come at you for seven innings, and for us to score early, makes it a little bit easier to play the game.
And then having just, you know, that win under your belt and just the automatic to the championship game, what does that mean for your team and for you as a coach?
Well, it's great that we get to the championship game. It makes things a little easier, but it's still a long way from winning, you know, winning the conference. All these teams playing right now can come back and play any time or beat anybody. So we can celebrate right now for a few minutes. They'll get focused because they can come back and put a whipping on us. So but it feels good being ahead right now.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Coach, and congrats. Right, we'll see you tomorrow.
All right, thank you.
Well, I'm not sure what was better today. The interview skills of our very own Maddie Morris, those exciting words of Coach Repham, perhaps it was the pitching performance of Sale, but a late nomination, the celebrations of the Panthers of FIU. 4-1 your final here. FIU advances. Marshall will face the winner of our next game, Louisiana Tech, as they take on the Hilltoppers of Western Kentucky in an elimination game. I'm Josh West for our entire crew. That game, WKU and Louisiana Tech, follows here from Hattiesburg. We thank you for watching BN Sports, as again, it's your home for all of your Conference USA action.